Hey guys, Michael here. In today's video, I want to show you a little bit about the Modern Poker Theory video packages. So let's go. The package will be divided in three main parts. In part number one, I will be discussing about GTO solvers, the importance of GTO solvers, and the main differences between the most popular commercial GTO solvers, such as Monker Solver, PO Solver, and GTO Plus. We'll also include in this video series a quick Monker Solver tutorial, a quick GTO Plus tutorial, and an advanced PO Solver tutorial, which will focus on preflop charge generator, how to set up the files that you will be receiving with alongside this video package. So the preflop charts will include all of the preflop ranges for cash games that are included in Modern Poker Theory. Things like raising first in, defending versus open raises, defending versus three bets. I will also include all of the MTT charts that are also present in the book. Same thing, just raising first in, defending versus open raises, rejamming, calling versus rejams at different stack sizes and different positions that are included in the book. You will be able to access all of those from the preflop charts generators. You can very easily just copy paste them in PO Solver or any other solver or equity calculator that you will be interested in just comparing the ranges or studying them more in depth. So for the continuation bet. Now, when out of position leads out either of these bet sizes, IP has to have the option to raise, and we will give it the option to raise 40 or 45% of the pot. Something like that should be fine. We are also going to be including all-in raises anytime the stack to pot ratio is less than 3x the pot. So we don't need to include all-ins everywhere. Because of this setting, they will be included automatically. Now, when the action goes bet, raise, we need to give a 3-bet bet size to the out of position player, and we wanna give it 2.5x and 999 for all in. Let's remove this dot here. Then, as a 4-bet for IP, we include the all-in. And now for the other scenario, when out of position checks, IP bets, IP can bet two different bet sizes. Let's give it 33% of the pot and a bigger bet size. Let's give it 67% of the pot. And now the big blind or the out of position player needs to have a bet size to check raise. We can give it 40%. Again, IP then needs to have a size to 3-bet the flop, 2.5x, and all in, and then the 4-bet as all in. So this section is pretty much almost the same as on the flop. And then we need to set up the river bet sizes for both players. And for this, I just want to copy the turn bet sizes. I think this will also work well for the river in this situation. And now, we can edit the profiles and save this one. This one should actually, let's rename this one because this one was the deep stacks, I believe. I'm not sure, we can check it out, but now let's add the current one and let's name this one profile. And there you go. Now we have our these bet sizes saved here. And okay, the next step will be to build the tree. So we just click here. We can see how the memory needed for solving this tree is 1.8 gigabytes. The tree has been successfully built, and now we can click on the ROM solver. Here, from here, if we want to run this specific solver, we can select from the different accuracy settings. This is the Nash distance. Again, I explained this in detail in a section of the book in Modern Poker Theory. Let me just load it up here. This is the section of Nash distance. And from here, you can see how it is calculated and all of the details about it. Now, 0.5 should be fine. From here, we can select how many cores of our processor we want to use. For that, if you get the task manager from your computer, you can see how many logical processors you have in this computer. I have 8. And so I only want to use 7 because I want to leave one for the rest of my software to continue working properly. And then the next thing to choose is how much storage we want to be using. Basic storage, we have, if we use control plus click, we can select the minimum storage, and the turned ports will also include data from individual hands, and we can also use the extensive storage that also with the turned data fully stored and does not require any calculation. So these are the options that are given by the solver. For this example, let's go with the minimum storage. And now we can just select to run the solver. So we just have to run the solver. And now it will show us how many seconds is taken for the solution to be finalized. And this will automatically end when it hits the target EV. For now, it is 36.7. But after each iteration, this number will go down and go down until it finishes. Now I'm going to pause the video here and come back when this is already finished. Check out the play against the solution feature. From here, we want to export to Flopsilla Pro, so we leave this as live export to Flopsilla Pro. There are two main things you can do. You can play against the database, or you can play against the current selected tree. You can also play the drill against the current decision if you change the option to play against the current tree. So in this tree, for example, we can go check, and we might want to play only in the situation where IP bets and now out of position is faced with the decision to react to the continuation bet. So we are in this portion of the game tree. We go back to the play against the solution, and we can select to drill the current decision, and we are out of position. And we can also select to lock the hand for hero, so give us a hand, and just play the same hand over and over again. We can also select a range of hands that we might want to be learning how to play. So how to play middle pairs, weak pairs. But in this situation, we will not be using this. We will only choose the drill, the current decision, for example. So we have 8-6, bottom pair, face up, 1/3 of the pot bet size. We call, turn king of clubs, check. Now we face another bet. Now we have to decide if we call or fold our hand. Now, of course, we will not be raising with our bluff catcher here. And I think fine just folding now. And if we make a mistake, the program will tell us if we make a mistake. Here we can select the speed which we want this to be playing out, we have the option to, well, we can see here in the top left the total amount to call, the odds we're given, and the random number generator for 88 here, we might want to see that. In the show performance, we can toggle this on and off here, and this would show us our profit compared to the GTO for the entire range. Given the way we have been playing, this is for the last 29 hands. We can also choose to not show the hand versus range equity. And there are a couple modes we can select from here. We can choose the show the solution that shows you the EV of each action. So you can select always the correct action here. We can choose the no hints, so we will never get a hint of the actions. But what I like to use is the training mode. And this one, if you choose the wrong action, you will be shown, and then you will be shown, for example, here, let's say we make a mistake and we decide to fold this hand. This will tell us that this is not the best choice. So it will give us the chance to select again. Part number two is going to be about a deep run I had in one of a PokerStars World Championship of Online Poker, W Cup. It was a 1K event, which I made it to the final table, and it was a very interesting review and history. So the review will feature a lot of interesting hands that I mark for the specific use of this video series. I will be reviewing the hands using Pio Solver and other tools if required. The purpose of this review is going to be to familiarize the students with a professional player thought process over multiple hands. So how do I play? How do I think about the spots in game, and also reviewing them with a GTO solver, such as Pio Solver.
It's a cuff suit. We raise 2.25 since, okay, although there are a couple of short stacks, probably going for the min raise is better with the button and cutoff being so shallow. Button does 3-bet me, no all-in bet size. Now I have a decision with the ace jack, and I think this is the worst ace x offsuit that I'll be calling here. Maybe ace 10 could be called with some frequency. Let's check out the charts. So, raising first from, this is the hijack with 25 effective against the bottom versus 3-bet. So yeah, ace jacko, we can jam here sometimes against the GTO bottom tilting range. Now let's check out let's take a look to the bottom range here. What should the bottom we be 3-betting? So bottom defend versus hijack with 25. Should be going all in with some of these middle strength hands. Makes sense. Some sort of A6. A lot of these hands want to call. So what does the bottom want to be 3-betting me non-all-in here? Some offsuit A6, aces, jacks plus, ace king is queen suited, and a few bluffs. Yeah, against this range, I think ace jacko does pretty well either way. I like calling mostly. I think people might be missing some of these bluffs. So just calling potentially better than jamming, but could go either way. We call, flop comes king 4-4. We have the ace of spades, we check. IP bets 1/4 of the pot, even less than that, let's see. So, oh no, not the holding resource calculator, we need the standard calculator. So, 3.5 divided by 14.5, 24% of the pot seems reasonable. And here we have a decision with our hand. I decided to go for the checkmate race. Having the ace of spades is pretty sweet here. If he calls, we can jam in spade. If he just goes all in or something, we have an easy fold. If he calls and we break the turn, we just give up. So let's check out this strategy. Well, I check raising, he folded. So let's see if the solver agrees with our play. What if we can learn something from this one? So king of spades, four spades, four of diamonds. Okay. I will be checking my range here. We will have a lot of king X, a whole lot of king X here. We also have aces. We have a few 4x with the ace 4 and some flushers as well. So we check, and IP will exclusively want to bet 25% of the pot here, and then checking some hands, checking back king's full, checking back pocket jacks, 9s, 8s, 7s, 6s looks very reasonable here, and c-betting mostly ace king, aces, and then air. This looks very reasonable to me. The ace 2 on diamonds, which is interesting, also the ace 7 diamonds, and the ace queen on diamonds looks like our hands that IP actually wants to check back and try to realize equity instead of betting and having to bet fold hands that have a lot of potential backdoor equity. The third part of this video series will be 100 big blinds, no limit holding cash. For this, we'll be generating a aggregated report analysis from a big blind versus button and big blind versus under again, 97 flop subset. We'll aggregate the data and show you how can you also take advantage of all of these features, such as aggregated reports, analysis. I think this is something that is really important. It's very powerful. Of course, you will have to also use different tools such as Microsoft Excel or some sort of a spreadsheet that you can visualize the data generated from the solver. But I'll be showing you how I do it with Excel. It's not so difficult, just it's going to be focused on creating some tables, sorting the data, and making it more pleasant or more easy to digest via a few visualizations or things like that. It's not something too difficult to do. I will be showing you how to do it, and then I will also include in this video package all of the 97 flop solutions with PO Solver in PO Solver format, so you can access them if you own, if you happen to own PO Solver, you can load all of them. And I will also include Excel spreadsheets, so you can also just check them out the way I created them and replicate the steps by yourself in future aggregated data flops analysis. We'll also include a simple GTO trainer tutorial where I will show you how to set up the simple GTO trainer and also how to play against GTO solutions. I think this tool is something really, really nice. I also showed you a little bit of how to play against the GTO solution using GTO Plus. I will include that in the GTO Plus tutorial. And if you want to know more about that, you can go to the gtoplus.com website. But with this one, with the simple GTO trainer, you can use GTO solutions from PO Solver or from Simple Post Flop. So if you already have a library of solutions, this is a great tool to have. If you don't, if you want to use PO Solver for your main study, that's also very valuable to have the solutions from PO, and then use the simple GTO training to play against the GTO solutions. I will be showing you how to play against the solutions including in the pack, so you can try them by yourself. All right, I really hope you guys enjoyed this. This was Michael for DNB Poker, and see you next time. Flops where IP range will be, will have some portion of his range that is very polarized. So he wants to bet that polarized portion on the flop using a very large bet size, and then check back a lot of the rest, plus a few slow plays or strong hands that protect the range. So what type of hands? How do the ranges look like? Well, we can come here and just open one of those. Looks like the ace king three, right? So ace king three is the highest overbet frequency. So let's open that flop. And we can see here that after the big blind checks, indeed, most of IP range really wants to overbet. Now, if we compare the EV of overbetting against betting one third, we can see very clearly here how some hands in IP range really benefit from using the overbet. Like ace king is going to be plus 4.9 chips, which is a lot. A big blind is 10 chips. So this is almost one half of a big blind gain by ace king when you choose to overbet. Same for pocket threes. This is massive gain. And then these hands, queens, jacks, and tens, these benefit more from betting small. But these hands, as we can see here in the overall strategy, are not even bet, they are checked. So what's key here is that, yeah, there are some portions on IP range that really benefit from using the larger bet size, the overbet. And in this flop, ace king three, the best strategy for the bottom will be to overbet, betting around 30 to 35% of his hands, and then checking back 60% of the time. All of the hands that really want to check, like pocket queens, pocket jacks, pocket tens, pocket nines. Right? So what do you do with pocket aces, which is the nuts here? Well, this hand, looking at EV, is a slightly higher EV, betting two thirds, but in reality, it's pretty much indifferent, just a small fractional points here. So you can do whatever you want with this hand. If you're going to use other bet sizes, you can put aces there sometimes to balance them out. But for the most part, in this flop, what I would recommend is only going for the two thirds, sorry, for the overbet. And then check back a lot. And well, I will be splitting my aces probably. If you look at this strategy, aces want to check back around 27% of the time. So you can probably just do around one third of the time, check back your aces, and then the rest of the time, overbet along the other hands in your range that really want to overbet. How do you build your c-betting range in this board? Well, the stronger range, the strongest hands. Like ace, well, first there's a threshold in top pairs. You look at ace queen is the strongest top pair, and it's going to be mostly continuation bet. Then ace jack can start to check sometimes back, ace 10 checks a little bit more, ace 9 checks a little bit more, and so on until you get up to ace 4, ace 2, which are gonna check most of the time. Ace 3 is, of course, two pair, and mostly wants to continuation bet. Looking at this, the EV of betting, overbetting, and checking, there's a small difference, but the general idea is that you want to build your range around the hands that really benefit from betting right now. Now, if you bet small, the big blind should only fall about one third of the time here. If you go for the overbet, the big blind should fold around 60% of the time. So you benefit by generating a lot of full equity, and at the same time, the strongest portions of your range, right, like ace king, for example, pocket threes, all of those hands will benefit because they can get immediate value from a lot of these hands that are not even folding to the overbet. Then, once the big blind calls and the turn breaks, let's say maybe the three of spades, so it's a bigger brick, and he checks back. Now this strategy is going to be to overbet again as the in position play, because we still have a lot of these really strong hands that want to put a lot of money in the pot. So should proceed with the overbet again. Now the big blind should be folding around 54% of his hands, and now you can see how hands like nine, ace nine, as strong as ace nine and ace 10 are becoming indifferent and can be folded now. So even ace 10 is a much worse hand than ace 9 because ace 10 blocks a lot of the IP bluffs that include a 10. So looking back here, Jack 10 and Queen 10 are some of the main bluff hands, and 10 9 is also a bluff hand here. So Having a 10 in your hand is particularly bad, and in this situation against the overbet, ace 10 is a worse call than ace 9, ace 8, because they don't block as many bluffs. Okay, so if the big blind calls again in the river, let's say, okay, let's make the turn something like the two of spades, same thing. And we can even look at the hotness feature here to see the IP strategy. And you can see that on most of the turn cards, IP really wants to overbet. Only on a heart, IP wants to bet small, mostly one third of the pot. So this is right here, very good insight. What's your strategy? Well, you overbet the pot on the flop. Then on the turn, you mostly want to overbet and then keep checking back some hands that are not as strong to overbet again. So what does our overbet range look like? Well, keep overbetting ace queen, of course, ace jack. A lot of these ace x can keep overbetting two pairs and bluffs. You want to keep overbetting with bluffs like queen jack, queen 10, jack 10, all of these type of hands. These small pocket pairs are good bluffing cards. The middling ones are, if you still have some of those, are better to just check them back now. And then you want to check back some of the weaker ace x with some frequency, so you still have some top pairs when you check back. Of course, your top of range definitely wants to keep putting a lot of money into the pot now. And yeah, once the big blind calls one more time and everything breaks on the river, let's say the brick is the river, something like the eight of diamonds, so an absolute brick. The big blind range here contains a bunch of ace x, some flush draws that break now, and some second pairs, like some king x and stuff like that. So now the play for IP is just to go all in for slightly more than pot. Now the big blind is in a very difficult spot again with a lot of his hands where he has to fold 54% of the time.
So let's say we want to drill the node where it goes check and then bet. So we are going to be drilling defense against continuation bets. We could also do this for turns and rivers. I will take just more time calculating, computing. And here you can see how this decision point, the node, is our column, semicolumn, our column zero. So we need to enter this here, our column zero. Column again, right? Column C, column B, column 18. And now we just check this one. We need to give it some time. It will check all of these flops and see if this node exists in each one of them. And then we will be able to add the drilling in this spot. So I'm gonna pause the video and come back here. Okay, I think I made a mistake and put a semicolumn here that was not necessary. So just click here and check again. Now, yeah, it shows how it goes over each one of the flops. Just making sure that this branch of the game tree is valid in each one of the flops that you have in the folder. The folder, if you want to check out how it looks like, we are Dropbox, the video packs, the advanced pack, you can see the defense. Nope, it should be line here, big blind versus bottom, and there you go. Here are all of the flops that were run from the script. Now once this finishes going over all of them,
we will be able to play our drill. Now, you only have to do this process once. After it is finished, you get to play your drill over and over again. So again, I'm just going to pause the video and be right back. All right, so this is now finished and it shows the action of IP check and then IP bet. Now we have the options here to check raise, call or fault. And yeah, so we wanna be drilling against the small c-bet size. Let's save this. And now it says regular and we have the drill option here as well. So now we can train against the solution. It will take a few seconds to get to the exact point in the hand we are testing, which is the defense against the continuation bet. And now we can see that we have all of the actions in multiples of 25% because that's what we set this drill for, multiples of 25. Now, if I want to change something, it will only go from 25 to zero. So I cannot choose an action 10% of the time, I can only choose something 25, 15. I think this is easier because in reality, it is very difficult to mix up things, something like 10% only, or you know, a small fraction of the time. But unless you're using a random number generator in game, like in a small bet size here, we just only want to call now. We don't want to raise or fold this hand ever. So now the GTO evaluation that says that this is correct, giving us a new hand. 5-5-4, jack 9, this hand is just going to be a pure fold again. I'm just going to fold this hand always. Now it's computing, it says again that the evaluation is correct. 6-3, bottom pair on this king 6-2 board, middle pair actually. I'm thinking that maybe we want to check raise this hand with some frequency. And we don't really want to fold, so maybe this mix 25-75. Let's try it out. And again, we are correct here. King 10 on ace ace jack. This hand we definitely just want to call. I don't think we want to be doing anything else but calling these. So let's just call. And we are correct again. So I'll just leave it like that in this one. D76 on this board, we have